All right, today on the bench, the mind reader innator, that's how my daughter calls it, but it's actually a Strobotac from Genrad, and I demonstrated it to my daughter.
Look at it go! Oh wait, it's a bit harder to capture, but yeah.
Yeah, because the camera is also has a certain number of frames per second, right?
It do.
And it worked for a while, and then it went shoof, and some white smoke came out of this hole. So I think I burned a capacitor innator in there. But look at that beauty. It's supposedly made with tubes, and they still make a version of that today that looks almost the same. It's transistorized now, and it will cost you $8,500, I think. But this one, of course, is an eBay find for a few tens of dollars. All right, let's tear into it. Oh, you looked at the patent?
So, I pulled up the patent number that appears on the front of the device, and it turns out the patent is from Harold Edgerton, which is the famous MIT guy who invented the strobe and did the early strobe photography. So this isn't just random strobe.
It's historical.
It's like the strobe guy.
It's the stroboscope. Man, I didn't know. I thought it looked so good, I had to buy it.
He did all the famous early...
Oh, he did the stuff. Milk thing. He's Mr. Milkman.
Yeah, the bullet going through an apple. Milk drop, atomic bombs. So this is the guy.
Wow. This is the machine. What was the date on the patent?
This one is 1935.
Yeah, that's, and 1935 is the first version of the Strobotac, which is this but in bigger. And the Strobotac, with a stroboscopic tachometer, is powered by a strobotron tube light. The strobotron.
So they have a schematic here, which looks like it's driven by a motor.
Oh, well, that's how they made the oscillator at first. Yeah, I think it has only two or three tubes in it. It's very relatively simple. Here are the simplified schematics of our 1531 Strobotac. The heart of the device is the strobotron tube. It is a xenon-filled tube, so really the strobotron is a xenon arc flash bulb. As you can see in the diagram, the anode and the cathode of the strobotron are connected to a high voltage capacitor, charged at 800 volts. However, that voltage is not sufficient to ionize the xenon and get it to light up. To initiate the arc discharge, you need a much higher voltage pulse. That pulse is applied to many trigger electrodes depicted on the left of the tube. The trigger voltage pulse is far higher, in the many kilovolts range. Once the xenon gas is ionized by the high voltage pulse, the tube will then arc between the anode and the cathode, sustained by the 800 volts stored in our capacitor. The arc will last until the capacitor is discharged, hence it will only emit a brief flash of intense white light, which can then be used for stroboscopy, or alternately to attempt to read your mind. The rest of the circuit comprises a relaxation oscillator, which uses a double triode tube. Note that the oscillator can also be wired into a Schmitt trigger. This allows the Strobotac to be triggered by an external signal instead, usually to synchronize it to an external event. We'll demonstrate that useful feature in a follow-up video. The pulse generated by the oscillator is then fed to a thyrotron, which is yet another gas discharge tube. It will produce a high-intensity pulse, driving the primary of a high-voltage transformer. The secondary of the transformer will increase the pulse voltage to many kilovolts, which is then used to trigger our strobotron. Finally, there is a simple power supply. It uses two diodes and two caps to form a voltage doubler that generates plus and minus 400 volts. These two voltages are used to recharge our strobotron capacitor to 800 volts. The full schematics are quite a bit more complicated, but the general principle remains. So one tube is a double tube, and there's a
tyrosol in it. Should be all kind of good stuff.
So this is built by General Radio, who also are the people who made the Variac.
Really? Okay, so that's moving. That's moving. It's held here. There we go. Whew. All right, so any sign of where the magic smoke could have come in? The magic smoke escapes to the front. And it came out here, but it might have come out there because that's the only place for smoke to escape.
Are there any high voltage capacitors in there?
Oh yes, you bet. So they tell you have to move this in the two positions to discharge them, which I did. 800 volts. Okay, it looks like they have a trick hinge mechanism. You get that one off. This is what. It does.
Nice.
All right. Oh. Okay. There is a capacitor. I see some slight thing that could have been a burn, but I think it's an input capacitor or an output capacitor. There would have been nothing hooked to it. That look burned to you?
It looks a little suspicious. A little maybe bubbly.
Oh. Here's smoke.
Yeah, it's just looking at that
okay. Right there. Okay, let's see. Where do we spot the smoke? Oh, you can't see it from there.
Right there.
It makes the sound of a venting cap, to be honest. So I was wondering if this big cap, which is the main filtering cap, went poof this direction.
Does it pull out or is it?
No, it's a triple cap, which is annoying, but I was expecting to see more damage in this thing. Well, you know, it might be the high voltage capacitors in there too.
After a few minutes of troubleshooting.
So far, we have one unhappy diode, but it's not a shorted diode. It's a diode that has a 4 junction of 1 point something volts. And then we have the main cap here is good. This guy is at least 3 caps. On the section 67, then he has 230, oops, 30 microfarad ones. Which is turned out to be 30 and 30. So that's good. But the one next door, which is this guy here, is very unhappy. And I think that's the one that might have blown up. 70 nanofarads. It looks a little bit blown up to me. Can you see that too, Ken?
Yeah, it looks like that. And just kind of tilted.
Yeah, it overpressured. Uh-oh. That might be it. I might be oil. That's the envelope, so that could not be that catastrophic. It leaked, but I was concerned about this here. Looked like a bulge to me. 77, where is it? There. Nanofarad, so it's dead. Alright, so let's see. C3, let's see on the schematics. So it's right here. So it's 400 volts. So I need 10 micro 400 volts. Man, do I have that? All right, went on and did a few repairs. The capacitor, I don't have a 10 microfarad 475 volts, but I have a 22 microfarad 450 volts. It should be close enough. And I consulted with my insurance agent and he was fine with it. Here the diode, this is in SB2, some vintage silicon diode in my pile of stuff. I looked correct, I tested it on the IV curve and it goes up to 700 volts and the original is at 450 volts, so that will work. The capacitor here goes to nowhere. That's the output capacitor for triggering another flash. So it shouldn't do anything. I measured that it measures fine, although it has this little suspicious dot here. I have, so it's rated to 2 kilovolts. The only 2 kilovolts I have are 0.47 nanofarad, but at this point I'm not just going to change it and worry with it too much, because I think this might be just cosmetic. It looks a bit more than cosmetic, but so let's see if it repaired the strobotachinator. Okay. So the tube instruments, you have to let it go a few seconds. So far it didn't blow up, but it's not anatering either. Nope. So something else blown up. So they tell you, go one this way, one this way, one this way, one that way, to get a discharge. So why? All right, this is a scary beast, I have to say. So let's see if we have voltages that we should have. It was 430 volts, so that's not bad. That and that should be also 400 volts. And it's only minus 2 volts. Well, is that the diode I replaced that's in the wrong orientation? So I am suspicious of my diode here. What? Wouldn't you know it? They put it in the different direction than this guy. Is the opposite polarity. So apparently this guy is packaged in the other direction. Okay, so 2SB2. Oh yeah, it's written on it. Different package orientation. It's a Japanese diode. I would have never guessed that. Woohoo, it's hot. The package had the opposite orientation. And we're going to match, yep, this diode orientation with the little symbol. So it doesn't look correct, but it is. Yes, 400 volts. So it was the diode put the wrong way. Put this angry machine back in its wooden box. It's in metallic box, not wooden at all. Read the magnetometer times 2. Oh, 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 oh. It is flashing. Okay, we repaired the redominator. So that was all it was. So I've now hooked it up to my frequency generator here. And I can do whatever I want. That's the external input thingy. There are two settings. There is settings for fast. And there's a setting for slow. Okay, it appears to work. Excellent. This is what I was doing with my daughter. I showed her that
it was not a rebindinator, it was a stroboscopic thing, and we could slow down the movement of anything. We could slow time down. Okay, let me see if I can capture this on camera. It's pretty hard because the frame rate of the camera itself interacts with it. So here we can't see anything, but if I get the Strobotac going, I can slow down time to a standstill. I have magic powers. There I go. Get it super close. But it's all an illusion. Okay, anyhow, the Strobotac works. It can read your mind. All right, excellent purchase.